Hey folks, David Frost, my strategic forecaster, here for another episode of Common Sense Market Analysis. Today is Wednesday, January 2, 2019. Happy New Year to everybody. Welcome to 2019. It's going to be a blockbuster year. We're going to go over everything we need to go over on the charts. What I'd like to do is give a quick review of what happened really for the month of December, right? It was a pretty wild and crazy month in the markets. We're going to do that real briefly just to kind of get back up to speed. We have a new year. We have a reset. Let's start the year fresh with a fresh look at the markets. Let's understand what we've got in front of us and let's use it to our advantage to make some money in 2019 through these markets. Before we really get rolling, let me once again thank everybody who participates, making comments and posts underneath the video. I love the interaction. Please step it up. Keep up the great work. It's helpful to everybody in the community. It's only going to grow. Thank you so much for your participation. In addition, please hit the thumbs up button on the video and share the video with anybody that you think can benefit from this information. All right, so where are we in terms of the overall market in the big picture? Let's work from the big picture backwards. That's the best use of our time today. The big picture right now is obvious. We're in a downtrend, and this is nothing other than a bounce, could be called a dead cat bounce for now, but right now it's just a bounce in a downtrending market. No more, no less. We don't need to know anymore, and we don't need to think about the long term right now. For now, that's all we really need to know. The month of December was wild and woolly. Let's take a look at the weekly chart just to give a refresher of where we are and what happened. So we can see that we came into the 200-week moving average. We identified that level, 234.59. That's been on the chart for quite some time. So that level held. We weren't 100% sure that it would hold. However, so far, it held. We'll get back into whether or not it's going to hold going forward. However, right now it held. That's all we really need to know. We do need to make some adjustments to some of the other numbers on the charts. Maybe we don't need some. Maybe we have others that are important. Now, before we go back to the daily chart, I just want to point something out that's extremely important. And this goes to something that we really need to focus on if we want to learn in 2019 enough that we can use this information to our advantage to make money. That's what this is all about. Everything else is BS. If we can't use it to make money, then it's not working and we have to try something different. However, this does work, and if you want to make money, pay attention because this is extremely important. What I'm going to go over now can be applied to a 10-minute chart, an hourly chart, or any other chart for that matter. Right now, we're on the weekly chart, and look what happened. In the bigger picture, there were really two areas that were extremely important and that would provide, under normal conditions, support for the market. They're breakout areas. We know, because I've said it 1,000 times, that markets love to come back and test former breakout and former breakdown areas. Now, I would consider two breakout areas like this. Here's one, and then here's another one right below it. There's also a gap that we discussed before. So here's a gap at 234.59. The market came down. It actually went below that gap by just a little bit, making a low, let's move the chart over, made a low of 233.76, and then you can see the type of snapback once the market decided, at least from an interim perspective, that was going to be the low. Now, further that, we were looking for a low within the time period that we found the low. We were looking for a low at the latest of last Wednesday. We found the low, and here we are. Now, when you go back to the daily chart, you can see here that the low, here was the 24th, and here was the 26th. In between was Christmas. We found the low, and here we are rallying up. Now, the question is, and this is really where the rubber meets the road, where do we go from here? Where's the likely resistance area? Are we going to go higher? Are we going to collapse back down? Where are the support levels underneath? What the heck is going to happen? That's what we need to answer, but we need to make sure that we have it in our mind that we're going to take one step at a time. I say that because I seem to get into these discussions back and forth with a lot of traders about what they think the long-term view is. Some think it's bullish, some think it's bearish. It doesn't matter what they think, it doesn't matter what I think, it doesn't matter what you think. What all that matters is what the market is doing. And the reason why I circle back to that is because we have to take it one step at a time. We're only concerned with where's the near-term resistance, where's the near-term support. If we break near-term resistance, what happens next? Where's the next one? If we break near-term support, where's the next one? And that's the way we let the market stair-step its way to our important support and resistance areas. Now, we know from the course at Lazy E-Mini Trader that how the market gets there and what the market does when it gets there is how we make money. That's what's important. Okay, fine. That makes sense. That's in the course. We all know that stuff. Those of you that have taken the course understand exactly what I'm referring to. And why do I bring this up right now on the daily chart? Is because one's setting up right now. I can smell a setup coming. I'll get back to that in a second. But what I want to mention before I forget is anybody that thinks January is going to be quiet and that all the volatility is behind us, it was in December or it was in 2018 and everything's going to be clear sailing going forward, that's wrong. There's going to be plenty of volatility in January. January is packed to the top of the bucket with what promises to be excitement in the markets. And here's the deal, folks. The market volatility is a trader's best friend. Very hard for a trader to make money in a market that just goes up every single day. Now, we'll do the same thing as everybody else. We'll just buy and hold. That's the only way. But in a market that goes up and down during the day, every day, each and every day is something different. That's a market that we can make a fortune in if you know what you're doing. All right, let's get into where we are right now. What's going to happen from here? What's the likely scenario? First of all, the market was down rather large overnight. That's the S&P E-mini futures, the NASDAQ futures, the Dow futures. Everything was down overnight. China was getting hit hard, and ultimately, we were set to have a pretty horrible day here in the markets. But as you know, the market turned around early in the morning and really powered forward all day long. So here's an hourly chart. Now, here's the opening today. This is the 10:30 candle. So this is the candle that opened at 9:30 Eastern and closed at 10:30. And you can see the opening price was all the way down at 246.06. We closed at 250.26. That's a tremendous rally off of a gap down this morning. Remember the 246.31? You think that number's still important? I do. Maybe it's not to the penny, but I think it was important. It was important before. It was important this morning. It'll be important again until it's not. But with that being said, let's make a minor adjustment, and then I'll explain the adjustment. We've moved the number down slightly to 245.95. It's simply the low of today. That's our bogey on the downside, the low of today. We don't want to see hourly closes below the low of today. But here we're going to get a little granular because there is a breakup candle and that low happens to be 244.02. And you see how even these levels from a visual perspective look rather close together. That's 20 S&P handles apart. That's $2 in the SPY. So it's obviously worth noting and worth mentioning and keeping an eye on. So we have two important levels. We'll call it 246 for rounding purposes and then 244. Now, what happens if we begin closing hourly below 244? Well, from a visual perspective, it would look like 242 was next up on the docket, but it's not. Instead, we move it down slightly to 241. Beyond that, we're likely to go down and retest the old lows or lower. Not saying we will, I'm just saying this is what we have to contend with on the downside from a support perspective. Now let's talk about the flip side. Back to the daily chart. So here we have a situation where everything is sloping down, meaning all the moving averages. We're obviously in a downtrend. However, we were very, very oversold. Remember Homebase? We haven't talked about Homebase in a while, but look how far away we got from Homebase. Homebase is the 20-period moving average, and the market got far extended away from home base. The market doesn't like that. Therefore, we have that snapback type of situation going on right now. But keep in mind, until it's not, it's just a dead cat bounce. The next important level of resistance on the upside is going to be in the neighborhood of 255. Maybe it's 255 and a quarter. Maybe they go up to, and depending on where it is tomorrow, maybe spike through a little bit the 20-period moving average, maybe even up to 256. What I'm suggesting is that under normal conditions, the market's not going to have an easy time getting up through that area. If we do, that's fantastic. There are plenty of other levels up above, all the way up to around 263 to 265. There's a whole nother ball game going on up there. Why do I say that? Again, this is something right out of the course. It's a breakdown area. So look what happened. Let me draw it out. So we came down and we found some kind of a low. The market found an semblance of a low. We tried to rally up, and then they couldn't do it. They gave up the ghost, and that was the breakdown. That's an area that they're likely to come back to and test, and if they do, they're not going to just walk through that area. I don't know if we get up that high right now, but nevertheless, if we did, that's an area that there's almost no chance. There's always a little chance, but there's almost no chance the market just walks right through that area without a fight. What's the human side of that? So we're talking about technicals. I'm giving you numbers of where the chart is likely to go or where the SPY or the S&P is likely to go. But what's the human side of this? Why is the breakdown area a price area or price level where it's likely to be met with resistance? The human side is, and we've all done this, please let me just get back to even. I'll get out and I'll never, ever, ever do it again. So when I say that, what I'm saying is that there are plenty of people, traders, investors, mutual funds, pension funds, you name it, doesn't make any difference. There are plenty of people who are willing sellers of whatever they're holding. Could be stocks, could be the S&P, could be the NASDAQ, doesn't matter what it is. There will be plenty of sellers if the market gets back to this area that say, I'm out. I'll take my licks. Maybe it's a small loss. Maybe it's a break even. Maybe it's a little gain, but I don't want to go through that again. Therefore, I'm out until further notice. Just so happens that that area coincides with a gap, the 50 period moving average all the way up at 265. It's far away from where we are now. It's 150 S&P handles. However, if you remember what I said before the market went down, when we started talking about the rubber band that broke, right? And we started talking about the breaking scenario up here. And this was the reason, pivot low, pivot low. Once we started closing below those pivots, that was it. There was almost no chance for the market to recover. And that's where I was saying, if we get below a certain area, the rubber band's going to break. So it broke, but then if you remember, I said, once we find the bottom, wherever that interim bottom is going to be, we're going to be up 150 S&P handles in no time, and then the rest will decide after that. Well, we've already been up over 150 S&P handles, almost 200 from the bottom. It happens fast. It happens before anybody realizes it happened. And one thing I can assure you of, that if we did get up to 265, and they even may start doing it at 255, they'll start, and when I say they, it's the media, the talking heads, the pundits. They'll start discussing, that was the bottom, that was the correction, it's off to the races, we're good from here. We know they're going to do that. They were getting bearish at the lows, they'll get bullish again at some highs, wherever those highs are going to be. With the market, we expect the unexpected sometimes. With the media, we just expect the expected. Now, before, I made mention of something that's in the course, and it has to do with time being more important than price. So imagine this, and those of you that have taken the course will know exactly where I'm coming from. Look at the time, and I don't mean the clock, I mean the amount of time from the bottom, and then start to think about coming into an important price at an important time, and when important price meets important time, sounds like a recipe for a date to me. Swipe left, swipe right, whatever it is you do on those dating apps, I wouldn't know. I've been married longer than some of you young guns have been alive. But the point is, important price, important time, a convergence, I'm looking at 255. And so how do we treat that? Let's say the market gets to 255 tomorrow or Friday, whatever it is. What am I doing if it gets to 255? Well, I'm going down to first an hourly chart, and I'm going to see what the chart is telling me. And by the way, I forgot to make mention of this before when we were on the hourly chart. What is that? What is that telling us the market is trying to do? What is it telling us the market wants to do? Now, if we get a close on an hourly basis below today's low, I'm going to change my tune a little bit on that. But until and unless that happens, that's a bullish pattern that wants to send the market higher. The longer we consolidate sideways, the higher the market wants to go. And you can see right here is an area that's likely going to stop the market, at least on an interim basis. How do you refine that number and get granular on what number really is going to stop the market? That's what's in the course. Obviously, along with, how do you determine a sign or a signal of a trend change? All those things, those are the things that we put together, the piece parts or the components that we put together to make the trade. Let's move over to the IWM. So I want to go to the daily chart. The IWM was absolutely just crushed over the last few months. The only reason I bring that up is not to be Captain Obvious, but because the IWM is my favorite market leading indicator. A number one. My second one is the transports. We'll get to those in a moment. Almost every single day, the IWM is indicating what the major markets want to do. It's either leading in the upward or downward direction almost every day. At some point during the day, it's typically disconnected from the SPY and the triple Qs if, in fact, the market is poised to go higher or lower. The IWM will typically move first. The IWM had a nice turnaround today, just like everything else, and it was up on the day, outpacing the S&P 500. So it's a puzzle piece. It's on the table. I do take a lot of cues from the IWM. Also taking cues from the transports. Now, all these charts look the same. The resistance areas are going to be similar in nature. You can go from one chart to the next and decipher where that same general resistance area is, from the spiders to the Qs to the IWM to the transports. They're all going to be around the same general area. Why is that? Because the markets are all trading together. They're all going to go up together. They're all going to go down together. Not the same magnitude, not the same every single day, but generally speaking, you're still going to have resistance areas in the same general zones. So for example, this is one right here. You're going to have resistance right here. You're also going to have resistance up here. It's the same general areas we discussed in the spider. Again, I would just keep in mind important prices at important timings. I'll be very interested to see how the market acts if it does get up into the areas previously discussed. Now, if not, and we just turn around and go back down the other way, well, we have our support levels on the other side. The NASDAQ market, the triple Qs, same routine. All charts look the same. However, the triple Qs are more bullish than some of the others. The next area of resistance on the Qs is right around that 20 period moving average where it is now. It'll slope down, so tomorrow it'll be a different number. But right around 158, 158 and a half is going to be resistance on the Qs. Getting above that, and you'll go all the way up into this area here, similar area that we discussed in the spiders. Here are the financials. So this is the XLF. And what you'll notice in the XLF is it looks more bullish than the other charts that we just looked at. So we know one thing is for sure. Without the financials, the market is unlikely to follow suit. What I mean by that is if the financials are not breaking down, the market's not going to break down. Unlikely. If the financials are going higher, then there's likely going to be some follow through with the major markets. The financials are a good leading indicator. Just like the IWM, just like the transports, the financials are a big part of the overall market, a huge part. They're typically going to sniff out a problem. So right now, we're still in this oversold rally, dead cat bounce scenario, but the financials look slightly better. So I would look for them to make a run to try and get back to 25. I don't know if they'll make it, but at least let them get halfway home, 24 and a half. I think it's possible in the XLF. SMH, all charts look the same. What can I say? At the expense of sounding like a broken record, the 50-period moving average on this chart is likely the area that, if we do continue higher, that's the area of likely resistance. Just remember, price and time. Put them together, and you generally have a winning trade on your hands. Switching gears, here's a chart of gold. So where is gold headed? Gold put in a little bit of a pseudo doji candle today, but it's in an uptrend. So we're not going to short gold. It's in an uptrend. We don't want to short uptrends unless we have a very, very high level of confidence in a resistance area. Where's gold going? 1295 in the near term is likely. And if it can get through 1295, the next major area is all the way up near 1320, believe it or not. Crude oil looks very similar to the SPY, to the markets. It's not the same, but basically the market went down, or crude oil went down with the market. Now it's having a dead cat bounce with the market. Can they get it up to $50? It's possible. I'm not 100% sure of that one. 48, maybe 49. There's a little gap window here, and then there's a gap, and that gap actually is at $50.20. That's possible. That will be resistance if they can get there. And with that, folks, I'm going to wrap it on the first new trading day of 2019. I'm David Frost, My Strategic Forecast. Thanks for tuning in for another episode of Common Sense Market Analysis.